Hello, House of Destiny family. I am bringing to you another missions update on how your seeds of love are impacting children's lives all around the world. For those of you who know, and many of you who don't, we are in many countries all around the world making an impact. India, Uganda, Cambodia, Israel, you name it, we are there. For example, in Guatemala, one of the facts is that more than 55% of the population, they sadly live below the poverty line. That's over half of the country that live below that line. And it's sad because many things that are able to aid in the change of that statistic, they don't have access to. And it's something that's so simple as education. Here in the United States, any child can go to school for absolutely nothing. But in Guatemala, these children aren't so blessed. Education is something that is a privilege. And so education aids in the change of that statistic. It can reduce developmental delays and literacy gaps across all ages. And where your seeds of love come in is we are able to provide a space for these children to come and receive education from all ages. You're talking from kindergarten all the way up through upper class, and they are able to receive resources that can get them into universities, into college, and begin to change a true statistic. You are a part of that, changing lives for generations to come, setting them up for a solid future and foundation. And that all comes, and it begins with education. And Desiree right here, she represents that. She's a child in Guatemala who is receiving education. She is receiving all of these resources and will go to, I mean, majority of them, they're gonna be the first that will ever be able to graduate, ever be able to provide for their family in such a great way. Moving on to Cambodia, you know, research shows that children in Cambodia have some of the most extreme dental cases in the world. And when you think of dental cases, you know, they attribute to infection in the blood. They can be fatal if not treated. And so you're talking about all of these children who sometimes never see a dentist. On that, there is only one dentist for every 100,000 people in Cambodia. As opposed to here in the US, you have 61 dentists for every 100,000 people. That's an incredible difference. And so the supply and the demand is incredibly wild. And we have been able to go and provide dentists for these children. For numbers' sake, 285 children with 1,585 decayed teeth, they received treatment through your gifts of love. That resulted in 1,551 fluoride varnishes. That also continued to 590 teeth sealants and 61 fillings. Now you add all that up and you're like, oh, that's great, they got their teeth done. But no, their lives have been saved. You've prevented infection. You've prevented sometimes even a fatal outcome. Because of your seeds of love, you are not only giving hope, but you are rescuing lives. You are setting them up to change their future and to be an example for future generations to come. If you follow the link at the bottom of your screen now, you can give into this movement. You can be the hands and feet of Jesus and be confident to know that your seeds do not lay flat. They go to work and they go before you and they do make a difference.
Come to you with my hands open wide, and I come to you with my heart like a child, 'cause I know who you are, and I know what you want. My praise, and I give it to you. Hey, Warriors, I got that song a few years ago, and I was worshiping the Lord in, I guess it was Detroit maybe, and it's a beautiful song that I felt like worshiping the Lord with today. Okay, good things are happening. We are learning about, we're going into a bit of history. Now, last week I taught you about Babel, the Tower of Babel, right from the beginning, and what communication is, language, why it's so important to God. So we're going to carry on with that today. I appreciate you tweeting me. For those who are not on following me on Twitter, it's Prophet Kim. And have a look at our homepage sometime. Go to kimclement.com, kimclement.tv. Look at the the VODs. And see the stuff we've got there, the beautiful stuff, and the prophecies that the Lord gives me about the nations, about America, and about it all affects us. The energy crisis, all these things God spoke prior to it happening. And it just takes a bit of obedience on my part. You're never going to get anywhere. You're never going to know. You're never going to know until you step out of the boat. You've got to try it sometimes. You know, when Simon Peter stepped out in the water and walked on it, it must have been an incredible thing for him in his faith. And then, of course, he started doubting, you know, and God, Jesus restored him. But I'm saying to you, you've got to step out sometimes to be able to give what God wants you to give us. He's never going to do the mundane. God's always going to do something unusual. And when you do something unusual, God does something unusual. And so, you know, I believe in this, that when the Bible says you draw near to God, He'll draw near to you. In what I was teaching about God making us the masters of our time, the earth, giving us dominion over the earth, I also fully realize that we have to do something to draw Him. And I've noticed that he, most of the time, it's you that initiates. He's expecting you to initiate it. For instance, draw near to God and He will draw near to you. Knock and it shall be. And He's making you do, and He'll open the door and give and it shall be given. It's almost like He's waiting for us to do so He can be drawn into our world. So I encourage you today to think about that. And let's go back to what we were teaching last week and be reminded. God removes the original language of the Tower of Babel, the language He gave Adam, and then He gives them languages which we have today, and that's just natural languages. We read in Acts chapter 2 that this was given back to mankind. What was given back? Well, the Word was given back. Now, let's go back to that and let's talk about that, because I shared last week about the fact that in the beginning was the Word. Which beginning? There's only one beginning with God. And that is in Genesis, because God is in timelessness and eternity, and so there's no space or time. So there's one beginning, and that's in Genesis. In that beginning was the Word. What's she trying to say? When God breathed into the dust, made Adam breathe, what did He do? He spoke. He spoke His Word. That was Christ. Now, the Word had to come. When the Word had come, then God gave them a language which came out of the Word. Try and think of it like this. God gave the Word to Adam. The Word is Christ. Christ is the expression of the Godhead. He is the expression. So what I'm saying to you is, when Adam had the Word in him, it meant that his expression was based on the Word that he had inside of him. Now, that Word, of course, went back to God, because Adam fell and saw himself naked, and from that point onwards, he did not have the powerful expression that he had once before. Now, all of that's important for you to understand, because we're talking about the infilling of the Holy Spirit, and my teaching to you, and there's so many of you watching interested in this, find somebody right now. Get a text out. Say, please go on to kimclement.tv. Watch what's going on here. He's teaching us about the infilling of the Spirit from a prophetic perspective. And during my meeting, you'll have an opportunity to be a partaker as well to help us get this, because I brought this into your home. It costs us money, but not based on that. The fact that in every teaching, we give to the Lord. But remember something now, as I just said to you, you initiate it. When the Word was taken, the Word returned to the earth in the form of a man. That Word was Jesus Christ. That's what He was called. Now, on the day of Pentecost, what did they receive? They had already received the Word, Jesus Christ. So now what they needed was the expression of the Word. I hope I'm making sense here. In other words, the expression of the Spirit is only based on the Word. It's not based on your Word. It's based on His Word, Christ. If Christ is in you, guess what? The Spirit is drawn to you. Now,
That's what I'm trying to say. What is the expression of the Spirit? It's not just speaking in other tongues. It's the expression of the Word. In other words, let me say it like this. If I have a word in me, how are you ever going to know what that word is unless there's a voice to that word? For instance, now I've got 7 words in me. You don't know what they are until I say, I love you very much and I care. So I'm just giving you an example. So the word has to have a voice. It has to have an expression. And so on the day of Pentecost, they were one place, one accord, just like they were in Babylon. And now suddenly there came a sound from heaven. What is the sound? The sound was the sound that Adam heard. The sound was the same sound that Adam heard and ran away from. Now the sound is coming back to mankind because Jesus is in them, and the Spirit and the sound must rest upon them. So the sound comes from heaven like a mighty rushing wind, and it fills the whole house. When that happens, divided tongues as of fire set upon each one of them. Keep that in mind. So they have, now what is that for? For a divine expression. What you have now is a divine expression. Go up, Rina. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So the Spirit comes, the word lightens on the word inside of you. Who's the word? Jesus. And out comes a utterance which is spiritually perfect. Now, so what was restored on the day of Pentecost in the upper room? What was restored? Let's find out what it was that was given back to mankind that they lost in the beginning. And now on the day of Pentecost, they are given something, a few things. What was restored? What do you get when you are filled with the Spirit? Remember something, for those that have difficulty with this, stop saying, well, if I'm to be filled with the Spirit, I've got to speak in tongues. Just get that out the way right now. Think about it like this. If you've got Jesus, the Spirit's coming to you and it's hovering. And it wants to fill you, and it will fill you. We'll speak about the practicalities of it another time, because we're going to get there. But I'm giving you the history now so you understand what this is all about. What was restored on the day of Pentecost in the upper room? Number one, spiritual communication. Spiritual communication directly to God with the original language. So what is that spiritual communication? Now, somebody last week when I was ministering or praying, I felt that there was someone that could not speak. And they were saying in their heart, with tears, I don't have the ability to speak, so how am I ever going to do it? Well, the good thing about this is that the spiritual communication, now I'm not contradicting what I said by when I say if you don't have words, if there's a voice, there is such a thing as spiritual communication that does not require words sometimes, because there's no explanation given. In other words, the spiritual communication between Adam and God, of course, he used his voice, but there was also a spiritual force, which I'll share in a minute, that comes with the infilling of the Spirit that sometimes does not require words. And he spoke not one word, but it was loud. Your silence is deafening. When that kind of communication is also there and very valuable. Now, so what was restored is, number one, spiritual communication, speaking directly to God, and God speaking directly to you. Remember something, we are prophets, priests, and kings. So, what did the priest do? The priest would go to God, and he would speak to God on our behalf. The prophet would speak from God on his behalf to us. Let's talk about the priest and the prophet, and then also the king. These were the three orders in the kingdom of Israel and in the Old Testament. So today, what are they? First of all, the priest, the prophet, priest, and king is inside of you. All may prophesy, which means you have a prophetic anointing inside of you. So what does that do? It speaks on behalf of God to you and to others. Got it? Then there is the priest. The priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and he would speak to God on behalf of the people. So sad that we had to have this mediation going on. And we know that Christ does that now on our behalf. But inside of you, what is it that's inside of you? You have a prophetic anointing, a priestly anointing, and a kingly anointing. What does that mean? You don't need to go to a priest anymore, even though God will send you priests or teachers or whatever. You don't have to go to a prophet for a word even though that will happen from time to time, you have a prophetic anointing inside of you. The kingly anointing speaks of the action and the dominion part of aspect of it. So all that was given in the garden was taken away. The priestly anointing, the prophetic anointing, and the kingly anointing, which is contained in the word Jesus Christ. So you have inside of you, if you have Christ, you have a prophetic, priestly, and kingly anointing. Explain it again, Kim. Okay, well, first of all, the priest, prophetic anointing, let's start with the priest. The priestly, what would the priest do? He would speak to God on behalf of others. Your intercession is a priestly anointing. Your prayer time is a priestly anointing, even though you use the prophetic. Your praise to God, even though the prophetic is in there too, is a priestly thing. Okay, that's what he did. So he would carry the incense. All of that is priestly. To minister to the Lord was also priestly. And now I'm speaking about prophetic prayer, but now let me explain that to you. So that is the priestly aspect of your life. The king inside of you is the one that does the action, the dominion, the one that goes out and actually conquers. And that's the dominion aspect of it. What is the prophetic anointing in you? It's God speaking to you. Okay? So the prophet spoke to the people on behalf of God. The priest spoke to God on behalf of the people. Now, that's all very important to understand because all of that's inside of you now. You don't need to run to them to do it. Now, some people have a kingly office where they are kings in the kingdom, like or people that have a lot of wealth or have a lot of authority. They are kings in the kingdom, and sometimes God sends prophets to them to speak into their life. So that's the first one. What is the second thing that happened on the day of Pentecost that was restored? The sound of God. So there's a sound that you have now. Remember, they ran from the sound of God, not only in the garden, but Israel ran away from God for 16 miles. Remember what I taught you last week? Because they didn't want to hear his voice again. So now you have that restored in your life. Number three. Number two was the sound of God. Number three is what is given when you get receive the Holy Spirit? Spiritual power. Let's talk about that because you have to have spiritual power. When you get the Holy Spirit, you have spiritual power. Surely I have spiritual power if I don't have the Holy Spirit. Apparently not, because this is what it says. You shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit comes upon you. What was the power that they received? The power in the Greek is dunamis. I hope I'm not going too fast for you guys. Let's have a little break here. Let's drink some water. Because all of you watching are going to receive the Spirit of God in his fullness. Kim, aren't I just filled once? Absolutely not. You're filled and filled and filled. You don't have to go to church services to get it, even though it's good to do that. In fellowship, there will be an anointing that will come, and also you get the infilling of the Spirit, and I'll explain that in a while. But you want to be initially filled with the Spirit to have your expression. The word power in the Greek is dunamis. Dunamis. Now, does that mean dynamite? No, it doesn't mean dynamite, even though that's where the word comes from. But dynamite's noisy in it that makes a whole lot of dust. That's not constructive. Power. What does it mean? It means force. You have a force. It also means a miraculous power. That word there describes miraculous power. So through the Holy Spirit, miraculous things can happen for you. Let's stop trying to set everybody else straight. Let's talk about ourselves. Excuse me. That's called a hiccup. Now, what we've got is power for who? First and foremost, for me. I do not like it when people continually use their gift to try and get everybody else straight. Well, I got the power and I'm going to... No, hold on. Let's first work in your life. When I first started the Matrix series, I taught all of you watching me about the kingdom of God. Well, actually, it was about possessing your promise. And I spoke about that. We are... But first and foremost, the trees and then the hills and then the mountains. We've got to sort ourselves. The power must be used so that we can overcome, so that we can have a victorious life. So when you get the infilling of those who are baptized in the Holy Spirit, you get fire, and that's for the consuming factor. And then you also get the power, which is dunamis, which means force, miraculous power, strength, and violence. Oh, what do you mean violence? Okay, let me explain to you. The violent will take it by force, and that means those that have the power, those that have the in spirit, have the ability to take it by force. They're called the violent. It actually means dunamis. It's you have the power, and if you have to, you have to go to your enemy and say, okay, I have the power, and I will take this by force. if you do not surrender to it, because you have to surrender because of what Christ did, made an open show of you publicly when he went down and took captivity and made set them free. Understand this, the 3 days that Jesus spent in hell, listen, at that point was to make an open show of the enemy, of you, of the devil, and every one of your enemies. So he's already done it, and it was traditional in that when they did that, he would put his boot or his foot on the neck of his enemy. And that fulfilled the prophecy alone. So good news is we're in the kingdom of God, and we have the ability to do what? We have the ability to use the power that God gave us to overcome things in your life. There are things that are in your life right now, dear warriors, that you need to overcome. And you have the power to do it. Take advantage of it. Don't let the enemy lie to you and say you now you've been drained of that power. That's why prayer, prophetic prayer, is so important, because there's a restoration of the power of God, and the tongue, the expression you've been given, comes forth. Okay. So what is the fourth thing that was restored and given back to you and is given to you when you receive the Spirit? Is direction. I'm going to work on this one for a few minutes, because it's very important that we understand what this means. Direction. What does that mean? To be led by the Spirit. Now turn with me to Romans chapter 8, and we're going to deal with the leading of the Spirit. You may say, well, Kim, I know all about that. I know what it means to be led by the Spirit. Well, okay. Well, good for you. But now I'm going to show you why it's important that you are led by the Spirit that is inside of you. The Spirit is omnipresent. He can be here, and he can be in London. He can be in India. He can be, and he is right now. And I know there are a lot of you that are watching from these countries. And I bless you as you hear these words. We pray the Spirit would fill you and would affect the nation that you are in. But what does it mean to be led by the Spirit? Let's go to Romans chapter 8, verse 13 and 14. Let's read this. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the flesh, you will live. How? How will I live? Okay. How do I put to death the deeds of the flesh? How do I do that? Okay, so you understand that if you are led by the Spirit, if you live according to the flesh, you will die. What does that mean? We are going to die anyway. I know that. But I'm going to show you something about being led by the Spirit that can help you to avoid some of the things that are happening in your life. Kim, I don't know how to be led by the Spirit. I thought I could just speak in tongues and that was the end of it. No, you have to hear the voice that is inside of you. And it must direct you, the voice of the Spirit. Don't let the flesh direct you, because that's when you get yourself in a mess. The flesh makes a mess. So if your flesh says, do this, you're sowing corruption. And what happens is you reap death. You don't want to do that. And that's a very important fact, and I want to deal with that for a few minutes before we deal with the practicalities of the infilling of the Spirit. I think I'm teaching you a lot of good stuff, and it's helping you. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Now, I want to go back to the scripture again. I want to read it again in Romans so you get to understand what I'm saying. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. Well, Kim, aren't we all going to die? You're dying spiritually. You're not going to live. And you can also avoid things if you don't live according to the flesh. Now, it means don't be led by your flesh. My flesh wants this, so I'm going to do it. But if by the Spirit, that's what the infilling of the Spirit does, you put to death the deeds of the flesh, which is what? To want to do your own thing. Lawlessness. I don't care what anybody else says. Pride is leading you, and you're doing things out of knee-jerk stuff. And you got to understand that will cause a problem. But if you can do by the Spirit, you can put to death the deeds of the flesh. So the Spirit gives you the power to stop your impatience, to stop your anger, to stop all these things, or at least to bring it under control, because you need that. And he speaks about the nine fruits of the Spirit that you need in your life. That's what the Holy Spirit does inside of you. Now, if you can put to death the deeds of the flesh, you will live. How will you live? For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. So you have to be led by the Spirit to put to death the deeds of the flesh. Does that make sense to you? Like I've been teaching, if you do an obedience, you do one act of obedience, obliterates, destroys the descendants of your disobedient act. Do you understand that? That's powerful. So if you are led by the Spirit, you're the sons of God, and that will cause the deeds of the flesh to be destroyed. Because, I mean, you can't put to death them by poking yourself or putting a knife into yourself. You can't do that. You have to make decisions. However, if you're led by the Spirit, you're able to do it. Okay, let's go to Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Let's talk about our Savior, our Lord, our King, our Master, our everything, our beautiful God. Let's talk about Him. His name is Jesus. I'm so glad I met Him, aren't you? He's so exciting. Talks to me all the time through His Spirit. Because if the Word is inside of you, why can't He speak to you? Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Now, this is about the infilling of the Spirit. I'm just giving you a few scriptures to start with to get this lesson on its way. Then Jesus, after being filled with the Spirit, write that down. If you've got pens, and while you're doing it, get a hold of somebody and say, you've got to watch this. It's on for 24 hours or 48 hours, this teaching. And let them get on and watch it so they can understand. Many of you are great, great encouragers. And I thank you for tweeting me and sending emails. Some of you, we do read all the prayer requests that come in. We've got a staff that just does that. And I end up praying for them. And they make known your needs to me. And I like to pray. Am I enjoying it? I'm on an 18-month fast. I'm in the third month, going into the fourth month, actually, of this fast. And I want you to know something, that tremendous things are happening. And sometimes I'll just go onto my Twitter and just read some of your needs, and I'll pray for them. And it's very exciting for me to see what's happening. But I'm entering into a time that I never thought I'd enter into. And it's a very, very powerful time for me. And I'm getting filled with the Spirit every single day. I go into my garden and He's so happy. And we pray together and we have communion together. And I sometimes I just raise my hands and say nothing. And suddenly He just comes upon me. And it's the most beautiful thing. And I feel His presence. I want to provoke you to jealousy. I want you to do the same thing. Kim, I work from my... I also work. Don't worry. I do work. I do a lot of work in the day. But three times a day, I stand before Him. And I pray continually. Of course, that's what we can do as well. But I pray. And I want you to enter with me. If you haven't done yet, this fast. It's so easy. All you've got to do is give up something that it brings pleasure to you, and especially with food, and then join me. And then what we want to do is we want to get together. I was thinking in September the 30th, 2011, is the first. It's the beginning of the new year, the Israeli New Year, and I want to possibly go to Mount Carmel around that time and gather all of you. You'll have time to save up money. All of you that join me on the fast and in this prayer time together, and I want us to go there and crowd Mount Carmel and have one of the biggest spiritual parties that we've ever had. We'll praise and praise and praise and worship and dance on Mount Carmel. If we can get it, I'm going to try and get it and secure it. And then, or in Jerusalem, doesn't matter. And we will make our declarations, because I believe that 18 months from now, I'm going to be debt-free. You know what happened the other day? I'll tell you a very interesting story. You guys should hear this. I didn't tell you this. When I was in my early morning prayer time, I was having such an incredible time. I said to the Lord, at the end of these 18 months, God, I would like my debt. I would be clear of debt. And I'm talking about my ministry and my own life. Now, Kim, that's impossible. Well, first of all, the Lord's been telling us that we are going to have the death of debt. Which means there are going to be debts around, but I want to be debt-free. I want to be an example of what I prophesied. And so I want, by September 30th, 2011, I would like to be debt-free. As I'm saying that to you, my phone is next to me. I'm out in the garden. I have a special garden area, which is Jacob's Ladder, and I pray there, and I send it up the ladder. And as I pray, next to me is my phone. Now, I don't do texting when I pray. Very seldom I do that, but sometimes I just see it going on, so I looked. So as I was saying, Lord, by the end of the 18th month, I would like to be debt-free. I don't know how many of you would like to join me on that. I'm sure you will. Suddenly, out of the blue, now I don't get texts from anybody, but very few see my text, my phone number, because I get too many. I get thousands of emails and so on. But a number that I don't know comes up. As I'm saying it to God, and I said, you are so cool. God, you are so, so, so cool. He does these little things we don't notice. That's a problem. We're not looking at the little things. We're looking for the heavens to open up and you know, angels to come out. And we stop doing that. He loves simple things. Have you ever seen Forrest Gump? I love Forrest Gump because it spoke of God. It spoke of how He worked. The guys out there, not Forrest, but his friend, shaking his fist in one of the biggest storms, telling God, is that all you got? Why don't you kill me? And God doesn't. In fact, gives them the biggest catch. and shows his goodness. So I'm sitting there and I'm saying, God, I'm making this declaration. I know you want many of my worries and many of my partners and friends. And by the way, partners, I love you. Thank you for making this possible. And I'm praying for God's blessing on you. Thank you for writing me and encouraging me, especially after I gave that word regarding the president. I appreciate that very much. However, and I want to say this to you, that I want you to be debt free. I want God to open doors for you and to make things possible for you. And many of you have given, and I want God to reward you with that. Open the door so that you can be debt free within a day. Why not? Just one deal and you can be free. Kim, I can't see that. You better see it, because I'm telling you something, it can happen. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? If he could give Sarah a baby at 90-something years of age, surely he can take your miserable debt and get rid of it. All it takes is some action on our part and say, God, I want to sow into this. I want to sow into being debt-free. I'm telling you a story now, because I know I went off a little bit here, but maybe it's our time just to do that in our teaching, because every teaching, we have an opportunity to take advantage of a revelation that God's giving, and you can sow into that revelation. Do it today with me. I know you want to know what happened. So this thing flashes. I see, I don't recognize that number. It's nobody's name. I read it. Listen to what it says. Eliminate up to 82% of your debt today. Really? It says. Yes. I could not believe what I was reading. And I said, you did that with Bruce Almighty. And that was, you know, great and fun. I said, you just did a Bruce Almighty on me. I was eliminated. I said, so are you saying it's me 82% of my debt? That's good enough for me, God. And so I took that as a word. Listen, people, you cannot say those are just coincidences. Listen to me. God was, he's got a sense of humor. He'll take our technology and have fun with it. I don't know who these people are. I have no idea. I never answered them. And that's all it says. And it's a specific number in California. I'm praying and saying, God, I want my debt free by the end of this fast. That's my request. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Pop up comes this number. Eliminate up to 80% of your debt today. Really? It says the explanation in question mark. Yes. I said, okay, if that's how you wanted to communicate with me, I'm going to take that promise. How many of you watching me right now would like to take that promise? I know you're encouraged. Don't look at your circumstance and say, it's impossible. I say what God and the angel said to Sarah and to Abraham. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Say it with me now. All of you watching me, is anything too hard for the Lord? My debt clearance is not too hard for the Lord. I believe that revelation is coming to us right now. And I want you to join me. Come on. Because the Spirit of the Lord is really all over me right now. I'm listening to some of you internally, and you say, Kim, what does it take? Action. I believe with all of my heart. Give, and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running up, shall men heap into your bosom. You know what that means? Your future. The bosom there speaks of your destiny. You think about that for a minute. I love it. I feel the Spirit just moving. Some of you say, Kim, it looks like it'll never come to an end. Listen to me. I told you America is resilient. It's coming out of it. I don't care what the enemy's trying to do. You are part of this. And I want you to do me a favor right now. As the Lord just gave that revelation and did this to me, I want you to take that promise for yourselves. And if somebody's not watching, you say, well, what about them? You spread the message that God has a plan. So, well, Kim, I'm not doing the fast. Well, you are praying with me, aren't you? I want you to do me a favor. I want you to pray right now and take some action. Say, God, I just heard something from the prophet and my teacher today, and I'm going to do the same thing, and I'm going to sow. I've done some crazy sowing the last few weeks, actually. When I was in Nashville, and Marty Layton was losing his church. God said, give him $10,000. I said, God, we don't have it. God said, give it. Because if you do it, I will supply seed to the sower. You are the sower. God wants to supply seed. If you're not a sower, he cannot provide seed. He says, he'll provide seed to the sower. I want you to do me a favor. Let's do this action right now, before I even continue this teaching. If you want to be led by the Spirit, then we better start doing stuff like this. The Spirit is leading us to say, okay, We want this promise for ourselves. So we are going to sow right now as if we are debt free. Now that's a difficult one to do. It doesn't matter what you give today. All you do is listen, and whatever you're feeling in your spirit, say, I want to sow into this revelation and I want this to clear. If it can happen in one day, folks, if you don't believe that because you've lived with it so long, believe it, because I know. And I did that again when I went down to my friend who was raised from the dead through the prophetic word that I gave him. You know the story. I took an offering that we should have covered our expenses, and God said, give it to him. It was another $10,000. See, I need at least $250,000 to be able to get into the building and build the den the way I like it. That's just to get in. I'm not asking you for it. He's out there. He can do it. I've sown and sown and sown. And I've said, Lord, now give the sower some seed that so we can get on with it. Do it with me right now. And I'll play a song. But I want you to pray and say, God, I want this promise. And I believe it. I believe that nothing is too hard for you. Not my debt. Not the debt of my company or my business, my family. Not the debt of this nation. I'm going to sow in belief that you will do what you just promised through the prophet. Now pray and say, God, show me exactly what to give. He may whisper it. He may put an impression in your heart, but you feel what he tells you. Don't be excluded, please. Don't say, I'm not going to be a part of this. Yes, you are. I'm teaching you. I'm giving you what the Spirit's telling me. He wants to salvage your business, and if you lose it, he wants to give you two back. But right now, I want you to sow as I play for you now. Whatever he's told you, Lord, tell them what to give. And as they give it, take a note of as they give, Lord. This is our declaration. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? No. Therefore, I give believing that you will do the impossible. There's a red link over there. All you got to do is go to that. We'll take you a minute or two and give your offering by credit card. Now, if you cannot do it that way, there are other ways of doing it. You can send your offering in, but I want you to do something today, okay? Go ahead and do it. Here is my treasure. Give it to you. As I lift my hands in worship, lift my voice in praise, here is my treasure. It all belongs to you as I worship you. Go ahead and do it as I sing. Here is my treasure. It all belongs to you. Oh yes, as I lift my hands in worship, lift my voice in praise. Here is my treasure. It all belongs to you. As I worship you. And so, as you're giving now, Lord, take note. This is their treasure to you. Here is my treasure. I give it, yes, I give it to you. As I lift my hands in worship, as I lift my voice in praise, here is my treasure, it all belongs to you. Take it, Lord. Let the incense of the offering come before you. As we worship you, take the offering, their treasure, and use it, Lord, to clear their debt, our debt. Amen. You've been responsible by giving, but we're also to be responsible by not adding on to our debt. And we need to be prudent, and we need to be wise, and we need to act our wage. Act your wage. Whatever you get, act it. Now, giving is another thing. When God leads you to do something crazy sometimes, he will honor that. That's the leading of the Spirit I'm talking about. Let's talk about Jesus, and let's get back to this. Then Jesus, after being filled with the Spirit, returned to Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So, I'm going to show you something very quickly about this, because we're going to find this happening as I teach you on this Tuesday night, and you're joining me together. You're going to find a lot of this happening, that the Lord will suddenly explode on us, and you'll find that there will be miracles that will start happening. Look for them. Opportunities opening up to you, doors opening. After being filled with the Spirit, Jesus was led by that same Spirit into the wilderness. When he came out of the wilderness, he was filled with the power of the Spirit. So, being led by the Spirit started with Christ. Well, it started way before that, but for us, under his directorship. Now, go with me to Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. I love this time together. You guys have no clue how I love this time together, because when I saw how many of you are watching, when I first started, I think I've said this before, when I saw how many of you are watching, I was stunned. I said, are you sure that there are so many people watching my simple teaching? And then you started writing to me and said, please carry on with it. We're really enjoying it. And that really encouraged me. And so now I told my staff today, I said, this is my favorite moment. Besides the den, this is my favorite moment. I feel I'm connecting with warriors and giving them information and giving them what I received and then letting them flow in it with me. Galatians chapter 5 verse 16. I say then, says Paul, walk in the Spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Okay, we know that one. I've taught that. So you've got to walk in the Spirit. Let's move on. Galatians chapter 5 verse 18 says, but if the Spirit leads you, you are not under the law. In other words, if you're not led by the Spirit, you're going to act as if under the law. Because you'll create your own laws and you'll say, well, I better not do this, I better not do that. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Okay, that's a whole long story and old teaching already. And I tell you, he was one of the greatest teachers to me. And in fact, I have all of his manuals and stuff. Is Jack Hayford, Pastor Jack Hayford is fantastic. And you need to read some of his stuff. You know, in fact, I have a Jack Hayford Spirit-filled Bible that somebody sent to me. And it lay here for a while. I didn't know it was. And I opened it. It was a gift from one of you. And whenever I'm studying, I have my own Bible, I'm doing my own, because I have my own perspective of things. When I get stuck, I'll say, Jack, I need your help. And I'll grab the big old black Bible, the Jack Hayford Bible, and I'll pull it down. And you look in the notes, and they'll explain the whole thing to me. So if you want to get that, you should get it. And I wasn't asked to promote it, but I just bought another one today, and it's got like a blue cover, and it's really nice. It's called the Jack Hayford. It's actually called the Spirit-Filled Bible. The executive, of course, is Jack Hayford. And but read some of the stuff that he writes as well. Another person that you need to hear from is Dr. Mark Sharona. Brilliant. And I'm going to speak to you in a few minutes on the Kairos and the Chronos. But his teaching on the Kairos, which is a certain time, is incredible. I would encourage you to go onto Mark's his website. I don't know what it is. Go and get some of his material. These will help you guys and add, you know, these are themes that people that speak into my life. Who I'm going to have very shortly is the Arrows are coming back. And the Arrows, you know, remember the Arrows? They're going to do a little tour with me. And a woman that I greatly honor, the Reverend Fiona Desfontaine. And she's one of the greatest teachers, one of the greatest female teachers I've ever heard in my life. And I mean that. And she's going to be doing 8 lectures for me on possessing the land and various things. And she'll be coming in July, August. So you're going to have some fantastic things happening when we launch our partnership program. All of this stuff is going to be in there as well. Okay, now I'm rambling on a little bit here. Let me show you something about time, because the Spirit, the very important thing to understand is the Spirit is putting you in time. In other words, God has to get something done in a certain time. I'm going to read very quickly from my Bible about Zacharias. This is what happens to him. And I'm not going to do the whole thing, but Zacharias was, his wife was the daughter of Aaron. Her name was Elizabeth. And they were both, this is verse 6 of Luke chapter 1, they were both righteous before God. But they had no child because Elizabeth was barren, both well advanced in years. So it was, while Zacharias was a priest, this is before Christ was born, serving as a priest before God in the order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was burning incense when he went to the temple, and the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. We had a moment of incense here right now. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing on the right side of the altar of incense, And when Zacharias saw him, was troubled, and fear fell upon him. He said he was come to kill him because he was in the Holy of Holies, or the holy place. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, because John the Baptist was going to introduce Jesus. That's what prophets do. But he will be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. He will also be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And you all know what happened when that took place. When Mary had Jesus in her womb, and Elizabeth had John in her womb, when Mary came and they met each other, John leaped in Elizabeth's womb. And I just love that. There was a leaping because he was in the presence of the unborn Christ. It's a whole teaching just on that. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will also go before him in the spirit and the power of Elijah. And he tells what John the Baptist is going to do. And Zechariah said to the angel, now this is what I want you all to get. How shall I know this? Never say how. In fact, I'm going to quote something. Get the how out of you. Don't have how in your vocabulary when it comes to God. How shall I know this? For I am an old man and my wife is well advanced in years. And the angel said, I am Gabriel, and I stand in the presence of God, and was sent to speak to you and bring these glad tidings. But behold, you will be mute and not able to speak until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their own kairos. Now, I want you to understand, he's standing at a kairos moment, and I don't have time to teach on that, but the angel is saying it will be fulfilled in their own time. In other words, there's a problem here, Zacharias, in that you have basically, you have unbelief. So I'm going to shut your mouth, even though you are filled with the Spirit. Now, this is where I'm trying to tell somebody something about that, is that he's filled with the Spirit, but he's not going to speak. He's going to be mute. What does that mean? It means that his presence alone, just as the presence of the infilling of the Spirit, will bring these things to pass. But now the unbelief, why did this happen? And I'm going to stop at that point with that. Why is the angel saying that? Because time, very important that you understand, there's a time factor here. God has to do certain things in a certain time, as I explained to you last week, and I will explain in a few minutes. Kim, what's this got to do with the filling of the Spirit? Being led by the Spirit. The angel's coming and wanting to lead him by the Spirit that he was filled with. The guy has unbelief and insults the angel, basically, and he says, okay, you have to be dumb because your words are going to bring unbelief, but you're still filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, so, his unbelief could cause a problem. Time, his unbelief could cause a problem with the kairos time with God. God has a certain amount of time in which he can perform something. He set those time limitations himself. Let me explain that to you in about 2 minutes, because some of you were on my destiny course, the School of the Prophet, and you heard this in great detail. Genesis chapter 15, God speaks about the children of Israel before they're even born and says to Abraham, this is what's going to happen to what's inside of you, your child. And he says, he's talking about, of course, you know, he's talking about Israel, because that's what's that is going to be born, but Israel's going to come out of that. We all know that. But Abraham is questioning and saying, you know, I don't even know if I'm going to ever have this child, if this child will ever become a nation. And so God says to him, let me show you the future. Let me show you hundreds and hundreds of years out in time and tell you what's going to happen to them. God said to Abraham, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs. Speaking, in other words, he's talking about when Joseph was sold by the brothers, and of course, they went to Egypt, and eventually when Joseph died, of course, Israel became a stronger and stronger group of people, and the Egyptians began to oppress them. But this is before it's happened. God's telling Abraham, and this, that your descendants, this nation, will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them and will afflict them for 400 years. Hold it right there. What's that got to do with it? God has set a time. There must be a reason. We don't know, but he has to do something within 400 or 430 years. There's a little discrepancy there. It's not, it just means it's around 400 years, because Galatians speak about being 430 years, which is fine. It's that whole time period. He says they will afflict them for 400 years, And he says, the nation whom they serve, which is Egypt, I will judge. Afterwards, your child, the nation of Israel, or the Israelites, will come out with great possessions. So he's giving Abram a promise. They will be afflicted for 400 odd years, but they will come out with great possessions, because I'll judge that nation. Now, God, why did you leave it for so long? He says to Abram, now as for you, you'll go to your father in peace, and you'll be buried at a good old age. But listen to this now. Verse 16 says this. But in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. What is he talking about? Okay, let me explain that to you. So God set a time limit that this had to happen. He couldn't do it before 400 or 430 years because the Amorites represent all of the inhabitants of Canaan. So God's judgment must await its perfect timing. Are you getting what I'm saying? I know it's a little heavy, this, but I want you, you've got to understand the time issue and being led by the Spirit. Otherwise, you won't understand why I'm saying this. Everything has to happen at a certain point in time. Now, give or take a little bit, because God has to deal with mankind. So he's saying, I first have to judge the Amorites. Only then can they come into that area, return to the land, because the judgment would be lifted off the Amorites and won't affect the Israelites. So I have to do it in 400 years. Now, when this all happens, what? Moses stands before God, and God says, at the burning bush, I have a task for you to do. And Moses could have said no, and actually did. And so God has to deal. Why am I telling you this? Because he made you master of the of your time, but he has to complete things in time where you live through human beings. Let's talk about the two things. I'm going to deal with the one specifically. What does the word time mean? Okay, the two words for time, they're actually connected, they're relatives. Kairos, or some of you say Kairos, Kairos, Kairos is the Greek. And then the other one is Chronos. Now, I'm giving you a good little teaching, and then we're going to flow. Why am I telling you this? Because you know that you can only live 70, 80, or 90 years, or whatever, and then whatever has to be completed through you has to be done because of obedience. And God has to do it within the time that he set. Kairos is an occasion, a set or a proper time and a period of opportunity. So you have a certain amount of control over that. Now, you have control over time anyway. What is Chronos? This is what I want to talk to you about, because once we've dealt with the history and why this has to happen, you'll understand the Spirit and why it has to fill you, give you an expression, give you power, give you the ability to be directed by the Spirit and led so you can stay in time. Because if you lose time, people, what happens is you get out of time and everything goes wacko. It just goes crazy. You remember what happened to Jonah? God says, I want you in Nineveh. I need you there because the judgment is being set at a certain time. And so Jonah jumps in the boat and goes the other way. What's taking place? God has to get him because God has set a time limit for something to happen. You don't even realize it. There's a moment of victory and a moment of healing and a moment of deliverance that God has set for you. And he wants you to stay in the Spirit so you can get to that place. And so the whole thing happens. There's chaos and he gets chucked off the boat and he ends up in the belly of a big fish and he gets spat out and he's stinking of seaweed and stomach juices and stuff. But he gets there in God's time. Got it? What is Chronos? Chronos is a space of time that something can happen. That's why in Daniel it says, the devil wants to change time and law. You see? So God is in control. I know what some of you are saying. Well, how can you say God's not in control of time? He is, but he's given us freedom in time. So if we're disobedient, he has to move things around. That's how he made it. So Chronos is a space of time, a particular period for something to happen, an individual opportunity. In other words, God is saying, I want to do something in a certain time, and I'm giving you as an individual an opportunity to be a partaker of this great event. Whew, that's powerful. Destiny, it's called. You have it. And if you don't understand the journey of destiny, go get my course at the School of the Prophet on destiny. It's very powerful. And I deal with a lot of this stuff. So let's move on. What does Chronos mean? What does this time mean? Chronos means that God is relying upon a human being to perform the task with him in that period of time. Therefore, there has to be, look at me, synchronicity. In other words, you have to be with God, synchronized with Him, in order for you to enjoy this moment of great deliverance or whatever it is, so you can join the heroes of faith that we are surrounded with. Would you like to do that? You know what they did, the heroes of faith in Hebrews 11? They obtained a testimony. Have you obtained a testimony? So you can join the heroes of faith and stand, and they can cheer you on as you come in because you did something, because you stayed in step with the Spirit. You'll get out of it every now and then, but it doesn't mean, just because there's chaos, doesn't mean you're out of step with the Spirit, which you can learn about as well. So God has to perform a task through a human being in a period of time. Therefore, there has to be synchronicity. Say God has 20 years. He set a thing, I've got to do this in 12 years. Then He chooses people that have to synchronize with Him to get the job done. What does synchronize mean? Synchronize, it comes from two words, syn, S-Y-N, and chronos. Syn means, and you're going to love this, together in time. Now, let me divide that up. It's all to do with the infilling of the Spirit. Before I let you, some people say, well, just show me how to get full of the Spirit. No, you don't want that. You want this. What is this all about? What is the Spirit in me doing? Well, la maramaricana. No, it's not just that. As I've said, there's much more to it. You must be led by the Spirit in order to become or to obtain a testimony to do something incredible and fulfill it within the times. In other words, you are helping God. What? Yes, you are helping God. Okay. Almost done. So, syn chronos. It means together in time. Okay? It's together in time. Okay? That's time. That's a time. Okay? You're together. But it also means together in this time and space. Understand? So, it's saying you're going to have to be together with God in your time. In Ecclesiastes 3 verse 1 says, there is a time and a season for every occasion under heaven, for every purpose. So what does synchronos mean? Together in time. All of you watching me, no matter where you are, your kitchen, bar area, wherever you are, say it now. Together in time with God. Okay? He comes into your time and does a work. You say, well, He does it in His time. He has His time too, but we're not dealing with Kairos right now. We're dealing with Chronos. So, what does Chronos mean? Let's just do it quickly. It means to occur at the same time. It's from the Greek word synchronizein. So it means to be of the same time. I like this very much when I studied this. Synchronizein means to be of the same time. Hey, I love that. To be of the same time. What's God's time? I'm being of the same time with Him. It means to move, to operate, to work at the same rate. Come on now. How many of you are in a hurry and you want to get things done quickly? And you run ahead of time. And you're no longer synchronized. We all do it at some time or another in our lives. And God has to correct us. To move, to operate, to work at the same rate and exactly together with God. And it can be done. Genesis 5 verse 24. I love this. Enoch walked with God and he was not, for God took him. Have you ever read that before? I want to show you two little things. This phrase, walked with God, is only used twice in the Bible in this instance, in this sense. What does that mean? Enoch walked with God and was not, for God took him. What does walked with God means? I studied that up because this is what we're talking about, being led by the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit, to keep in step with the Spirit, to breathe in the Spirit. All of this is important stuff. Walk there, I checked it. What does it mean? What do you mean he was taken, God took him? You're going to love this, no, but ministers to you today. The word walked with God, or the phrase, this is what it means. This is what Enoch did. Walked with God was a massive thing. It means to walk, to be conversant, to converse with the spirit world. Almost I talk to angels? No. You speak to God. Angels will talk to you. So will demons. that you are aware of them. To be conversant, it means to walk with God means to depart and to be at ease. To enter, to exercise your faith, to follow along, to run, to flow, to prosper, to take away, to vanish. What is all this, Kim? Did you notice what I just said? It's constantly conversing. Paul said, pray without ceasing. To depart, to be at ease, to enter, to exercise, to follow along, to run, to flow, to slow down, to prosper, to take away, to vanish. Let me tell you what it means. It means in order to walk with God, so there's perfect synchronization, you have to sometimes hurry up, sometimes you slow down, sometimes you stand still, sometimes you follow, sometimes you run, sometimes you flow, sometimes you don't flow. It means that there are different moments that you have to be sensitive to. Please don't say, Kim, this is too heavy for me. No, it's not. It means you're sitting watching me now. You're slowing down, but you're exercising while you're there. What are you doing? Getting knowledge, exercising your faith. That's what you're doing, and you will be rewarded for it. I love that. God took him, Kim. What does it mean? It means to carry, to seize, and to mingle. What did I say about the rapture? I'll rapture it up now. I'll wrap it up. What did I say about the rapture earlier? I think it was last week I said it. I said, people must stop saying I don't believe in a rapture. I don't believe the reason for it, what people say. That which I just read to you is what I believe. Now, the vertical issue is we have dominion on the earth. Okay? We have the power to pray under prophetic guidance. And in that, under that guidance, once we pray like that, synchronization takes place. Because in prayer time, you're getting synchronized, God and you, so you can do it in His time. And when you walk with God, what happens is He mingles with you. I feel it right now. This happens to me a lot. He mingles. I can feel him, and he mingles with me. My whole body—it's so incredible. I can't explain. It's like there's fire all over me. He's mingling with me, and you disappear. Now, I'm not being weird, please. You vanish. Who's you? The flesh. That's what I'm talking about. The crucifixion of the flesh. That's what happens when you are led by the Spirit. We have so much more to talk about. And when you get filled with the Spirit, you're going to have all these things I spoke about. I bless you today. If somebody just came on, you didn't have an opportunity to give, do it right now. But I want to pray that you would receive the Spirit and that He'd remove all the obstacles that are standing in your way so we can get what God said to us today to a place where we're debt free and you walk with Him. And all of the flesh that's been exalted will vanish. Lord, I pray for the dear warriors that have joined me. Give them understanding. Give them dreams tonight. Let them have a clear touch from you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm sure you've heard me talk about this before, but if you're not on our email list, you're missing out on exclusive content and updates that we only share with our subscribers. Now, I want to take a moment to explain why subscribing to our email list is so important. First of all, social media algorithms and filters can be unpredictable. You may not always see my posts or updates, and they may even get censored, even if you follow me on multiple platforms. When you subscribe to our email list, you receive updates directly in your inbox, and no algorithm changes or censoring can interfere with that. Now, our emails are tailored specifically to you, and so subscribers get to see behind the scenes, stories, and exclusive content and updates that we share with no one else. So if you're a fan of our videos, you'll definitely want to subscribe to our email list, and I'll send you updates on new videos and even give you a sneak peek at upcoming projects. So, if you haven't already, I highly recommend subscribing to our email list. Just visit the link below and enter your email address. And if you're already following us on social media, thank you. But don't forget, subscribe to our email list for even more exclusive content and updates. Thanks for your support, and I'll see you in your inbox soon. We have recently joined with you at MyPillow, and you guys are sponsoring us. We have our promo code, Kim Clement, right?
It's our 20-year anniversary, everybody. Back in the summer, in July of 2004, when I invented MyPillow, the queen size, this is the patented fill, and this is the cotton cover we use on our sheets. So it's a very special limited edition pillow. The queen size, normally $69, I believe $98, $19.98 with their promo code there. $19.98, the king size. I didn't plan this either. They just happened to be in my office. The king size is $29.98. You guys, they're normally $79.98. So you're getting the best price of any MyPillow in history. If you go to the website, too, we still have some closeout slippers at $25 a pair. You'll never be $25. These slippers are closeout. Yeah. I run into people all the time. Mike, I have all your products. No, you don't. Do you know about our dish towels that just came in? The best dish towels you'll ever use in history, ever. And when we reverse engineer a product, we go problem solution. I want dish towels that dry the things, not that feel, my heart or whatever. I mean, it's disgusting. These actually work. These actually work. But yeah, use that promo code Ken Clements, everybody. And take advantage of that right now.